We are Christ's living undivided bride.
Rise up with an extraordinary love for God, that you are not moved by any other voice because you've shut the door, but you are only focused on the voice of God. Because there will be a time, if you want to go higher up the mountain, those close to you may persuade you different, but you got to know that you know that you know that you know. If I want a bucket of oil, I got to know who pours out the oil.
The church has tucked itself away as the world has come into the church, amen, and took center stage. And they're saying, be like me, and everybody will be happy. And the church has stepped aside and allowed the world to come in and take the center stage of the church. And God's saying it's time for the church to be the church. He says, a little leaven, leaven's a whole lot. There ain't one drop of flesh you can put in this tabernacle and let it remain. It must be washed by the blood. It must be sanctified by the fire of the Holy Ghost. The Word and the Spirit of God must come together to establish truth and release revelation.
Praise to you.
Listen to the sound.
Oh, yeah,
listen to the sound.
Like, Father, we're thankful to stand in your presence tonight, God. Oh, we lift up our hands to you. And we open our hearts up to you. And we declare tonight, Lord, that you and you alone are holy. You're so holy. You're holy. So holy are you.
On the throne, blessing and honor, glory and power. sits on the throne, blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Lamb. He sits on the throne, blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Lamb. He sits on the throne.
Let's
Yes, in every way wonderful.
He's wonderful. He is beautiful. Amen. We are so glad to have you here tonight at Revival for Christ Club International Ministries right here in Moore, Oklahoma. We are in our Apostles Conference tonight, and over the next three nights, we've got some amazing speakers. Tonight is Apostle Jenni Vanover. Tomorrow, Apostle Chuck McSweeney. We're going to start doing our Apostles Conference annually. We're going to start inviting in a lot of different apostles and ministers to come in because we want to bring those mantles together. We want to see a spiritual unity in the men and women of God. Amen. You can be seated if you want to. We've got a very special presentation tonight since it is our special Apostles Conference. I want you to welcome at this time the Mariah Dance Company with this special presentation.
Jenni Vanover. She is a licensed and ordained minister who has preached internationally and is operating the apostolic calling, moving with the freedom and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. She surrendered her heart and her life to Jesus Christ only at the age of 19 years old. What were you doing at 19 years old? She has over 30 plus years of ministry experience. Praise God. She has worked in all aspects of the ministry through Highway Alert, nursing home, hospitals, campus ministries, the award-winning Eagle Flights team, counseling. She's teach Sunday school, and she's teach various women workshops. This is a woman of God on the move to do something mighty for the Lord. Amen. She currently spearheads our Realm Women Warrior Ministry and conferences. Apostle Jennifer Vanover, alongside her husband, Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover, are the senior ministers right here at Revival for Christ Club International Ministries, where they work together to bring the body of Christ together through word and through spirit. Amen. Through the avenue of Christ apostolic, They influence today's Christian world. They also manage the Yellow Rose Dinner Theater, which is also a ministry that reaches thousands of the people. Amen. She is a dance choreographer, and Chief Apostle Timothy is the director. Now, her lifelong artistic passion is ballet. She has performed for the Texas Civic Ballet Company, and she has danced with the Saratoga, New York Hall of Fame. Amen. That is only one of the few colors on her coat. But tonight, you're going to see a color that was influenced from the red blood of Christ. She is a woman of God's holy power that is about to bring in deliverance and a healing to God's people. So if you are watching right now, God has something for you. You stay tuned. You buckle in, grab your Bible, and God's going to bring you to a new place. Amen. Her quote, "I am a woman with a two-edged sword. It is my heartfelt prayer to empower the body of Christ, to be an inspiration to the common man and a friend to the sinner. All honor and glory to God." I ask everyone to stand to their feet, and I have the privilege and the honor to introduce to you Apostle Jenni Vanover.
Amen. Thank you, Miss Tina, for the honor and respect. Thank you so much. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Everybody looks great tonight. I know you are in great anticipation. The Lord has wonderful things in store for his people. Please stand up to your feet, and I'm going to ask you to grab the hand of someone you don't pray for nearly enough. That's okay. Go on. Look around. We got a few people in the back. We don't want to forget them. And if you're a visitor this evening, welcome to Revival for Christ Club. We welcome you with open, loving arms, and we pray tonight that you feel the love of Jesus. All right, let's all lift up and honor the Lord this evening. Father, we thank you as we come unto your presence. Oh, God of our righteousness, we pray unto you. We cry out to you with our needs, with our tears, with our supplications. We as a people and a body of Christ lift up our hearts this evening. And we are asking tonight, Father, that you will meet us with your heavenly oil. Begin to pour out from heaven upon us. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, and the whole church say, amen and amen. And we're so glad that you all are here this evening. This being the very first of many Apostles' Conference. And those of you on live stream, welcome to Revival for Christ Club, International Ministries, a ministry that was birthed from a vision that was given a young man at 12 years old. My husband, Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover, and I am so blessed to say that for 30-something years of my life, I have been active in that vision. When I first heard the vision, my husband, Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover, came to San Antonio, Texas. I was sitting in a little building, didn't know anything about God. Didn't even know who Jesus was, and he began to share the vision of Revival for Christ Club. And if you have heard that vision, and those of you have had, I know that your heart is stirred, and that's why you are here today. And my heart was stirred. I knew that a small part of that vision was for me. And I am so blessed that I have been building and working in that vision for the last 30 something years of my life. All right, so this evening, I want to speak to everybody about a man named David. David was one, he was the greatest king of Israel, anointed by God as a young boy. He is described as having a heart after God. He was the youngest son of Jesse and took care of his father's sheep. His most famous saying, "The Lord is the one who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear. And he will deliver me this day from the Philistine giant." And God most assuredly did, if you know the story. God taught David as a young man to trust in him. In 1 Samuel 16, verse 13. Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed David in the midst of his brethren. And as he poured that anointing oil upon him, something began to happen. The Spirit and the presence of God fell upon David. And it was said that David walked in a presence of the Lord. And some of you today, you have felt the Spirit and the presence of God. You knew that from the time you were born, God had a special calling, a very special measure of oil anointed for you for the time period that you were alive upon this earth. The theme of this conference is the gathering of mantles. David's life was not by accident. Even though he had a heart after God, when he became king, he made a few mistakes. But the one thing about his character, when he was confronted with those mistakes, he acknowledged them. And then after he acknowledged them, he repented for them, and God forgave him. Please draw your attention to Psalms chapter 4. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Father God, this evening. We glorify your name. Thank you, Jesus. There was a time period in David's life before he became king that Saul, and Saul was the previous king by the people, but as King David was underneath him, Saul made David his armor bearer. And I just want you to pause and think about that for a moment. When you are an armor bearer of somebody, you are in their very close space. You are in the very private corners of their life. You are privy to information that many other people aren't. You might see them at their strongest, and you might see them at their weakest. But when God has given you an assignment to serve somebody, he does it because he wants to teach you. He wants to develop you. He has to bring you through a process of removing the flesh so that he can refine his anointed oil in you. And David was very loyal to Saul, even to the point that Saul came at a point in his life where he began to be jealous of the brilliance of David. When the brilliance and the anointing of Jesus Christ illuminates so bright in somebody, how do you react to it? Do not let your heart be full of envy. Realize you need to support them. You need to give God the glory, because when the brilliance and the anointing and the manifestation and the revelation of God is moving through that vessel, they have a great amount of Jesus Christ. And it's that you need to get your eyes upon and support them and pray for them and give God the glory. But in the story of David and King Saul, Saul became so jealous, and he went after David and he tried to slay him many times, even in the palace. And so many times David could have turned around and avenged himself and took the life of Saul, but he never did. He had the character and the integrity and a heart after God he never did. And as you are in your training, or maybe God has called you to be a mentee or a servant to somebody, take it with all of the heart that God has put within you. We learn the most from the people that God has connected us to when we have a good heart towards them out of love. When we've allowed God to remove bitterness and envy, and we've opened up ourselves in every possible way to truly love that person and to truly ask and say, Lord, give me the eyes that are observant so that I can learn how they talk to you. I can learn how they conduct themselves in situations. Help me, Lord, to see how they apply the word in their life. And Lord, help me when I see the human side to them, not to judge them, but to pick them up and to cover them with the blood of Jesus Christ. If you have that assignment, you must take it to heart and truly unto the Lord. Psalms verse 4 says, hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. And this is David speaking. Oh, thank you, God, for your spirit. Thank you, God, for your mercy. Thank you, God, you are the only righteous God, the creator of all of us. There is no answer that can answer any problem that we have like the righteousness of God. In ourselves, we can't be right. You might be hurting. You might want to try to find an answer to someone's problem. But the only answer is the righteousness of God. And we have to develop a lifestyle of walking with him, putting our hand in his hand, and allowing God to speak into our ear, coming to a place in our life where prayer is the most important thing that we do. You can never get farther with God. You can never get deeper in your relationship with the Lord until you learn how to have a life of prayer and an ear that is open to what the Spirit would say, an ear that is open unto the voice of God. We listen to so many voices. We're moved by the voice of people. King Saul's mistake is he was moved by the voice of people. But King David was the greatest king because he was moved by the voice and his relationship that he had with God. And tonight the Lord wants to teach you how to be more fine-tuned, how to be more detailed in your life and in your walk with the Lord. So David said, oh God of my righteousness, you have enlarged me. When I was in distress, have mercy upon me and hear my prayer. For you to develop in the Lord, your prayer needs to be, Lord, enlarge me. Open up my spiritual borders. When we start our relationship with Christ at the altar by realizing we are nothing but sinners, we can't live without him, and of making ourselves open to the Holy Spirit and the evidence and the baptism and the fire of the Holy Ghost by speaking in tongues, the next thing that we ought to do is open up our relationship and pray that God teaches us how to enlarge our spiritual life, how to open up our mind to the ways of God. And it's a process of leaving the past behind and opening ourselves up. But what we tend to do in the house of God is we get in our mind a formula and a procedure, and we want to jump from the altar to the pulpit in a matter of a week. We want to jump from the pew to the altar to the pulpit so that everybody can see now that our life is righteous in a matter of a day. But my friend, it doesn't work that way. God has a process of enlargement. And David says, when I was in distress, and let me break this down for you, times that you are disappointed, times that you are depressed, times that you have been dismayed, times that you find yourself down. David said, it was in those times I said, God, have mercy on me and hear my prayer. And every moment that you step on this earth, and in this time period that God brings life into your physical body, your prayer should be every moment of every day, have mercy upon me, God. Because in myself, I can't make the right decisions. In myself, I can't love people the way God is called. In myself, I can't even forgive myself. Have mercy upon me. Oh, God of our righteousness, hear us, Lord. Hear my prayer, Father. And part of that is us stopping to hear what God has to say in our very anointed special prayer time with him. Please bring your attention to 2 Samuel chapter 3. Now, as I've been talking to you about David, in 2 Samuel chapter 3, there is a woman, and I want you to remember her name, and her name is Rizpah. And this is the very first time we hear of her in verse 7. Saul had a concubine whose name was Rizpah. And if you know what a concubine is, it's an extra wife. All right, let's move on to 2 Samuel 21. Rizpah, the concubine of Saul, had only two sons. Their names were Armoni and Meph-Ishobeth. All right, 2 Samuel 21. So we're going to go into a little bit more in depth of Rizpah. There was a famine in verse 1 in the days of David. Now David is king. In the days of this famine, this lasted 3 years, year after year. When there's a famine in the land, there's trouble. There's a drought. There's no fruit. There's no harvest. There's no water. And this happened for 3 years, which is a very long time for anybody. We know by good sound teaching that number 3, anytime it is spoken of, God is trying to get our attention. In your walk with the Lord, you must have the Trinity. You have to have God, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost. And you have to learn how to hear the voice of the Lord. You have to learn how to walk with Jesus and apply his living word into your heart and your lifestyle. And you have to have an ear to hear what thus saith the Spirit unto the church, which is you. But when we omit any part of that 3 in our life, example, when you try to walk and you don't rely on the Spirit of God to lead and guide you, because the Word of God says, they that are led by the Spirit, they are the sons and the daughters of God. But if you try to serve the Lord by the legalistic thinking of the words written on this page, and not by the fire and the anointing and the presence of God, and the indwelling and the power of the Holy Ghost, with the evidence of speaking in tongues, you will still find yourself in a drought. You will find yourself without. If you try to live a life foolishly thinking that just by your attendance in church, maybe by a little hoya la mahatia namasi, and maybe by a little looking at the word, but not really following the master, the creator of all, God that created you, not truly following the plan that he has called you, then you're omitting the great Almighty out of your life. And you, my friend, and my brother and my sister, have found yourself in a spiritual drought. And David said, during this time, he said, I will go and I will ask the Lord I will inquire of the Lord. And as he did, the Lord answered him. How often, when you find yourself in trouble, do you turn to a friend? Do you turn to your mother? Do you turn to a brother? Or do you turn to God? You see, it's okay sometimes to share our struggles, but only after we've laid them at the feet of Jesus. Because God wants us to realize he is our source of life. He is our God who meets our supplications. He is our answer to all. And so the Lord answered David, and he said, it is for Saul and for his bloody house. And his bloody house. I just love how the Lord answered him. Because he slew the Gibeonites. Uh-oh, there was sin apparently under the reign of Saul. And so immediately David began to do something. And in verse 2, the king called the Gibeonites. And he said unto them, and we learn right here in this scripture, the Gibeonites were not of the children of Israel, but they were of the remnant of the Amorites. And the children of Israel had sworn unto them, and Saul sought to slay them in his zeal to the children of Israel and Judah. You see, there was a treaty made, and Saul didn't honor that treaty, and he sought to slay the Gibeonites, and because of that, there was wrongdoing. And so David went to talk to them, and this is what they told him. Wherefore David said unto the Gibeonites, what can I do for you? How can I make this right? When you have wronged somebody, do you seek out a way to make it right with your brother in the Lord? What about, let's just go a little bit deeper. What about in your family? You know, sometimes we treat family worse. The people that we see day and, you know, the people that put up with your nasty self? The people that put up with your unagreeable attitude? We take them for granted. But what do you do when suddenly God makes it to you, real to you, that you've treated them wrong? David said, what can I do for you? I just want to make it right. And I want to drop that into your spirit a little bit. If there's anybody that you have wronged in your life, go and make it right. Because you can't be more for God and trample your brothers and sisters behind you. You can't be more for God and treat your wife or your husband at home behind closed doors or your children awful and try to say, God bless me. It doesn't work that way. God will call you on the carpet on every detail in your life. And so he said, what can I do for you? And wherewith shall I make atonement that you may bless the inheritance of the Lord? And listen to what they said in verse 4. And the Gibeonites said, we don't want any silver, no gold of Saul, nor of his house. Neither for us shall thou kill any man in Israel. And he said, well, then what can I do? They said that we don't want anything that you can give us. Nothing materialistic can make up for the wrong that Saul did. We don't even want to take blood. And David's like, well, what can I do? And they answered the king, the man that consumed us and devised against us that we should be destroyed from remaining in any coasts of Israel. And listen to what they said in verse 6. Let seven men of his sons be delivered unto us, and we will hang them up unto the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, whom the Lord did choose. And the king said, all right, I'll do it. I'll give you those seven sons. And the king spared Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, because of the Lord's oath that was between them. All right, so let me just back up. So they tell him, we want seven sons. Why seven? On the seventh day, God rested. Seven stands for a spiritual perfection number. And I want you just to hold on to that for a moment. And so in verse 8, but the king took the two sons of Rizpah, as I told you earlier, she had two sons, whom she bare unto Saul, Armani and Mephibosheth, And then there were five sons of somebody else, and these were his grandsons. So all together, under the lineage and the bloodline of Saul, there were seven. And so David took all those seven, and in verse 9, he delivered them into the hands of the Gibeonites. And listen to what they did. They hanged them in the hill before the Lord. Now, as we read about a hill, I'm reminded of a scripture in the New Testament that we are to be a city set upon a hill so that our light may shine. But yet the Gibeonites took seven all into the sin, into the bloodline of Saul. And we're going to take that wrongdoing and we're going to take them up upon a hill and we're going to hang them. Because as we hang them, we're going to do something to them. And it says they hung them and they put them to death in the days of the harvest, in the first days, in the beginning of the barley harvest. And what they did as they hung them, they broke their arms and they broke their legs and they hung them up for everyone to see, for us to come into the spiritual perfection that God has called us. He has got to cut off the dead things in our life that cause us not to rest in Christ. You see, there are seven. There are abomination unto God. There are six things that God hates, but there are seven that are abomination unto him. Please turn with me in the Word of God to Proverbs chapter 6. In verse 16, these six things does the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination. And I want to break these down for you. And as I read these to you, perhaps you could ask yourself, maybe even take a big spiritual magnifying glass and turn it around and begin to look at your life. Because if you want God to enlarge you, you've got to be willing to look at your life. That's why the process of anointing, that's why the process of a calling truly established in God doesn't happen overnight. It is a plan of development. It is a lifelong process from the day you come into this earth to the moment you leave that God always causes you to self-examine and to look at yourself. And so it says, here are the seven. A proud look. You that has pride. Do any of you have pride? A lying tongue. Any time you told a lie on your brother or your sister, and I'm going to take this just a little bit deeper, we even lie to ourselves. We speak the worst things about ourselves. We have the lowest self-esteem. When we should be encouraging one another, how we speak to somebody else is most often a reflection of how we look at ourselves. A lying tongue and hands that shed innocent blood. Anytime somebody comes into the house of God and they are full of desire and full of vision, and you who run over there to cut off that vision, to rob them of their desire, you just shed innocent blood. It is our duty, it is our responsibility as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is our lifelong mission to repair those that have been hurt, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, recovery of sight to the blind, so that those who are lost may find Jesus. But you fall in there. You may not be behind the pulpit, but you are a part of the body of Christ. You have a calling. You have a purpose. Look for those that you can heal. And when you don't, it's an abomination to God. When somebody comes to the house of God and you distract them, and you're in their ear to where they can't hear the message, this is not playtime. This is his time. We have nothing more important than surrender ourselves. But when you're in their ear and you rip out the blessing because you had something so cute to talk about. You have robbed them. You have shed innocent blood. And God is not happy with that. And he will hold you accountable. And you will be stunted in your growth. You will not be enlarged. You will be small. Because you've made yourself small. And the Word of God goes on to say, a heart that deviseth wicked imaginations. Imagine that. Where your mind thinks, your heart follows. You who entertain evil thoughts. You know what we watch, and the world is full of it. It's accessible to little kids now. And somehow we don't want to be bothered with even monitoring the children on their devices. Because mom and daddy got to have their time on their devices. But there's so much evil entertainment out there. You don't need to feed your mind and your soul with that. And you wonder why your house is in mischief. You wonder why your kids won't listen to you. Because you haven't taken the spiritual authority. You haven't set the tone in the house. You haven't taken responsibility. You are the one God's entrusted that child to. You need to take some authority and be a parent for once. Spend some quality time. Talk to them. You know, I can get on that high horse. There's something we don't even do enough. Even in the body of Christ. We hear the Word of God. We want to be right out the door to feed our flesh, to take our nap. When God's called us to fellowship. When God's called us to talk to each other. Look in each other's eyes. Maybe the light and the brilliance in you will encourage the Christ and the brilliance in me. You know, the Word of God says we need to come to the house of God more ready to hear, more ready to give than to receive. When you come into this house of God, pray, Lord, how can I give? How can I hear my brother or my sister? Maybe there's somebody I can just wrap my arms around and just let them know I care. Are you really so busy you don't care? Are we really that busy? What are we busy doing? Last time I checked, it's just on a device. I'll step off that one. Feet that be swift in running to mischief. You know the feet that are like this? That was pretty good, huh? So-and-so's talking over there. That was great. So-and-so's talking over here. Think that be swift to hear that gossip. Ooh, we want to run to mischief. As if our life isn't complicated enough. But God says that is an abomination unto him. A false witness that speaks lies. And he that sows discord among the brethren. You know, God has given us in the body of Christ, in the church house, and we are blessed. I can't even talk about the abundant blessings in Revival for Christ Club. I didn't say we were perfect. Show me a group of people on this earth who are perfect. As long as we're in this body, as long as we're of a human state, we all fall short of the glory of God. But just like David, we need to call upon his mercy, and we need to run to the one who's righteous. I can't talk about enough of the goodness and the glory and the manifestations of the Spirit and the revelation that has come forth through this ministry. And those of you who are young and in the MIT program, I just want to encourage you to continue. Just absorb. Stay in the lane of being a student and learn, because it is a process of development. The Lord spoke to me, and this is what he told me. He said, we are in a season of tangibility. Revelation here. Revelation. Fruit. three apostles in Revival for Christ Club, delivering food, delivering revelation, and the fruit is tangible. Some of you in your study time, God's been opening up your understanding. Why? Because the realm and the season of tangibility is here. Absorb it. Don't predict in yourself, oh, maybe I'm called to be an apostle. No, it's the season of tangibility. What a blessing. Absorb it. When something is tangible, it is clearly understood. It's something that you can feel and something that you can taste. I can feel the presence of a mighty God in this place. I can taste the anointing. I can understand the revelation that God is delivering from his throne. And I want to encourage you to stay in the lane of being a student. Don't try to jump out of that lane before it's time. Be where God has called you. But in this ministry, God has given us a rope of hope. When you sow discord among the brethren, you cut it. You've cut off their hope. You have. No, nobody else. You did it. You spoke lies, judgment. When we get into our little, and we talk about a minister, because really, when we misjudge a situation or misinterpret a person, it's because we lack in relationship with that individual. So when we find ourselves in the little corners of, which we really ought not to be doing, you have cut yourself off from any rope of hope. And anyone else that you entertained in there, you've cut them off of any rope of being anything for God that has called them. And the word of God says that is an abomination unto the Lord. Please go back to 2 Samuel 21. Thank you, God. And so Rizpah, in these days, the daughter of Ai, she took sackcloth and spread it for her upon the rock. So here are seven men in the lineage of Saul. And the Gibeonites hung them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And then they broke their legs and they broke their hands. We need our legs broken. We need our hands broken from when we try to build our house or put our hands upon an understanding that we think we attained in ourselves. We need our legs broken when we try to walk in our own ways. But you know, Rizpah, the mother, and even though she wasn't related to the other five, that came from another woman, she did something. She took sackcloth. Sackcloth is goat's hair. And they used it for mourning. Y'all gonna love me. This is gonna be very comical. And she laid out the goat's the sackcloth. Now, she was on a hill. And these are grown men. So Rizpah, I'm assuming, was not a young woman. Yet she made the effort to still go up that hill. And the word of God says that as she laid the sackcloth out for her mourning, because, you know, these are her sons. It's a pretty sad deal. Was she like this? Maybe this? Maybe this? All right, let's see what she did. She laid the sackcloth and spread it upon the rock. From the beginning of harvest until water dropped upon them from heaven and suffered neither the birds of the air And so from the beginning of the spring of harvest unto autumn rain fell, she sat on the hill on her sackcloth, and she didn't let the birds of the sky to rest on the dead bodies or the beasts of the field. So the beginning of spring to autumn is about 6 months. An older woman who walked up a hill laid sackcloth out, and I know that this story is getting very crazy, but what lengths do you go to preserve your dead flesh? Sackcloth was a sign that she was in mourning. Some of us, when we're having a bad day, we go to great lengths so that everybody else can have a bad day. You are so attached to your pride and your lies and your discouragement and your negativity. And maybe it's not even that. Maybe God has tried to cut off from you flesh or a way of thinking or a habit. But you are so in love with it. And now I think about Rizpah. As she was on that hill, the Word of God says she kept the birds from feasting upon their dead flesh. And I'm sure they smelled. And at night she had to keep the beast. So that is like, out of here. That's why I didn't wear heels. 6 months. I would get tired maybe in 45 minutes. What lengths did she go? And everybody saw it. Everybody was aware. Rizpah was having a hard time. Oh, poor Rizpah, her two sons. Why did they have to suffer? And she was there mourning. What a sad, awful story. But God wants us to realize there are seven things, if we look just a little bit deeper in our life, that we need to get rid of. But we do the very same thing. Maybe it's not sackcloth, but if we're having a bad time, boy, we want to make a show of it. Man, everybody, life is just so rough for me. And not only that, she didn't just try to get the dead birds and the beasts off her two sons. She went for the other five. We attach ourselves to other people's drama. So much so, we want to keep it alive. In other words, let me break this down. When the Lord prays for you and God heals you of an infirmity, you pick it up the very next day. You get out your sackcloth and you make sure everybody knows how hurt you are. You want to keep that dead thing, even though anointed hands laid on you, even though it was prophesied over you, even though you have a mantle, you want to carry that dead thing like it's your best friend. And just like Rizpah, the Word of God says, we are supposed to be a city set upon a hill that those who see our light, but nobody can see your light because you're only keeping the dead flesh alive. And God wants us to change our mentality. What in you, if you look a little bit deeper, needs to go? Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Psalms 120. In verse 2, deliver my soul, O God, from lying lips and a deceitful tongue. How many times in a day do you put yourself down? Those who think less of themselves put others down. How many times in a day are you trying to preserve a dead flesh? How many times in a day are you trying to be like Rizpah? And so she did this. And in verse 11, it was told David what Rizpah was doing. And I imagine it's something like this. King David, there's a crazy lady on the hill. And I'm sure the first time he said, get rid of her. King David, she's still there from morning till night. And you want to see her. I mean, we all see the crazy lady on the hill with the dead hung bodies that smell. But somehow she's still mourning for them. She still loves them just like you when you love and embrace your sin. And then we love and embrace the sin of others. And instead of speaking the truth or helping them, we enable them in their weakness. Instead of allowing God to cut them off from the legs and cut this mind off, doesn't the Word of God say in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 3, we need to cast down every imagination. We need to bring into a captivity every thought into Jesus Christ. We need to put on the mind of Christ and think like Christ. Didn't Jesus say, now mind you, this happened on a rock. What else happened on a rock? Didn't Jesus say, on this rock, I will build my church? Well, Jesus can't build his church when you're trying to preserve those seven things that he wants out of your life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. So David went. And he took the bones of Saul and Jonathan, and he brought them up from Jabesh-Gilead, and he buried them. And then he took the seven dead bodies, and he buried them all together. You need to bury your sin. You need to bury your drama. You need to bury your carnal mind. You need to bury your negativity. You need to bury your lying lips. You need to bury your pride. You know that part of you that wants to raise up its ugly head when you think you've been overlooked, when you think you've been done wrong. I have been serving the Lord for 30-something years, and I can tell you that any time God calls you to go higher, there is a cost. He is going to want to cut off your flesh. There's going to be a sacrifice. I left everything, and I know I'm not speaking blindly here. Many of you have left your family to be what God has called you to be because there's a sacrifice and a cost for the anointing. As we were building Revival for Christ Club in the early days of this ministry, and I look back on it, we were in our 20s, believing in a vision, committed to God, faithfully serving God. There was a time period we had our ministry center over on North Classen. And I had the opportunity. My husband asked me, do you want to answer the phones and be receptionist and work in the ministry center during the day? And I was like, yes, absolutely yes. And then he told me, and at nighttime we have a 24-hour prayer line. You're going to have to man that too. Well, I didn't have a car. And that we had a big ministry center. It had different rooms. I lived in one of the rooms. And I did not have a couch or a bed, but I had couch cushions, which acted as my bed. And then I walked after I put my time in and answered the phones and was secretary for Revival for Christ Club and learned how to do my little typewriting, stationery. I went through lots of stationery, lots of prayer. I learned so much. That was my path. That was my development. And after I did that at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, then I walked up to Wendy's. I worked at Wendy's. After Wendy's, I got off at midnight. I walked back to the ministry center, and I answered the 24-hour prayer line. And I learned how to do it. Was my flesh tired? Yes. And I say this because that was my development. That was my sacrifice. And I had at that time just one little tiny bathroom with one little sink. And I learned, and I'm telling you, that I learned to wash my Wendy's uniform. I learned to use that sink as a tiny bathtub. Wash my hair. That was my development. That was my cost. Would it have been much more easier to have a nice car? Would it have been much more easier to have a better job? Would it have been much more pleasurable to have roommates and have a nice comfy bed and a big bathtub? Sure, I had all those things before I came to know Jesus, and they didn't make me happy. I would do anything for the gospel's sake. There was also a time period when we were building on the vision, and I've seen the vision of Revival for Christ take many facets. And there was a time, I'm so blessed, when my husband came to me and he said, God has given me ministry teams, and we're going to reach out. And this is when our ministry was in Stillwater, Oklahoma, and one of the teams was street team. And at that time, being 19 years old, going down to where the bars are by the student union, and talking to people after midnight about Jesus was definitely a learning experience for me, especially being the only girl on the team. And God would always tell me, go this way, go that way. And I would follow and I would listen, and there would always be somebody there. And so I'm thankful. I'm thankful for those times in my development that I learned to sacrifice my flesh. I remember when we started going out on Revival for Christ ministry, Eagle Flight teams, and my husband was preaching in different churches. We had just a one small vehicle with like eight of us crammed in it. And all these big trunks that said Eagle Flight Team with equipment and cassettes and different type of information about the ministry. And we were like this in a vehicle. All for the gospel's sake. And I wouldn't trade it for anything. Was I tired? Yes. Did my flesh want to complain? Sure, I'm human. But I learned through the process to allow God to cut off those things so that I could learn to go higher in God. And when we look at ourselves and we do detailed duty upon ourselves and we take the magnifying glass upon ourselves, God wants to extend his hand and his rope of hope, because he does have a calling. He does have a purpose. He does have a mantle for you. And he wants to take you higher. And he wants to hang up those things by the neck and cut them off that keep you connected to the earthly elements, that keep you connected to the drama in your family. You know, we get so caught up in the drama of our family that it keeps us in turmoil when God wants to cut all those things off. And so David buried all the bones. And he said, get that lady out of here. No, he didn't say that. But he might have. 1 John, please turn the Word of God to 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2. Beloved, now we are the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. Some of you are wondering, what is my place in the body of Christ? And I have heard it, the Lord say, do not predict. You are not so smart that out of your mouth you can predict what somebody else is called to be. Stay in your lane of being humble, of lifting up the God of righteousness, and only concentrating on your work, your drama, getting rid of those seven elements that could possibly be an abomination unto the Lord. And it says, what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, hallelujah, who is the he? Jesus Christ, when he shall appear, when the word of God is preached under power, authority, and anointing, and all of a sudden our spiritual ears are turned under the perfection of Jesus Christ, and what we hear, we begin to understand it is the manifestation of the anointing of God, and God is trying to rise us up out of the deadness of our flesh and to bring us into that spiritual place where we can rest in him. We shall be like him. He is the only one that gives the increase. God is the only one that drops the pure anointed oil into his vessels. And some of you, you said, why can't I be anointed like that? Because you're hanging on to that dead flesh. You're like Rizba. You want everybody to know you're going through something. You're making a show of it. You're talking about your struggles instead of doing something about it, when God already tried to eradicate it. Every time the word of God comes forth, he's eradicating your flesh. He's cutting off your sin. He's giving you a rope of hope. He is challenging you. Where will your passion be? Where will your desire be? Rizba had a lot. She was older. She put a lot of effort into it. You have the qualifications and the anointing in the power of the Spirit and the Word of God. how much more effort will you apply in your lifestyle and in your walk with the Lord? And the Word of God says, we shall be like him, for we shall see him. When you're alone at night and you're praying to God, or maybe you're just interceding and there's nobody around, and you lift up your hands and you feel the breath of God touching your spirit. It is that moment that he proves himself real and alive, and you feel that anointing, and God wants to pick you up and turn you around and move you higher where you thought you couldn't go. In the name of Jesus, please stand to your feet this evening. Let's lift up the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I'm going to ask Brother Frank to come here. Cheyenne, Priscilla. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Father, let's just lift him up. Shannon, come here. Let's just lift up the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. I want you to seek the Lord. I want you to get serious about the Lord. I want you to look for those seven things in your life that need to go right now. Lift them up to God. Yes, God. Thank you. Praise God. I was praying for you today. And the Lord told me to tell you that from the day you were born, he put a mark upon you. He put a seal and his mantle of anointing. And the Lord said, daughter, I have a called and anointed purpose for you, saith the Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. Let it be accomplished, Father, in Jesus. Yes, God. Praise God. The Lord told me to tell you this. The Word of God says, take no thought, for in that time and in that hour, what you shall speak. For in that selfsame hour, it is the Holy Ghost that speaks through you. Take no thought. In the name of Jesus, he wants to eradicate your thoughts. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let her see, God, all the areas of detail where she needs to eradicate her thoughts in the name of Jesus. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Praise God. The Lord told me that this is a season of joy for you. But the Lord also told me to tell you to enjoy it. Because in your life, there's going to be many seasons. And as you move from one season to the next, it will be different. And the Lord told me to tell you, it's all going to be him in his time. And every season that you walk in, that you absorb yourself in, will be full. Your heart will be full of joy. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Yes, God. Thank you, God. Let's just lift up the Lord. Thank you, God. Lift him up. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Upon the Lord and seek him. Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm international evangelist and administrative vice president of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our over 17 churches in the Philippines, to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send in your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.